Good morning, church.
Good morning.
The watchword for the week reads, Jesus said, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Jesus said, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. John 14 and verse 27. I welcome us all this morning in the sanctuary, those listening on Zoom, Facebook, and YouTube. Let us all stand as we go to the call to worship. Come, one and all, gather together, for this is the day of the Lord.
Let's gather at the river by the throne of God, for there is blessing forever.
From the throne of God flows a mighty river of peace and hope for all God's people.
And there shall be rejoicing at the sight of the healing waters.
Our journey brings us to God's wondrous river of life.
Praise to God who has drawn us from darkness and filled our world with light.
We blend our voices as we sing the hymn, How Great Thou Art. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder.
Oh,
to praise and give thanks for God's great goodness and the blessings we receive from God during every hour of every day, and for the experiences we have had throughout our whole life, when God has showered us and all creation with so many wondrous, wonderful blessings. We praise God for the reliability and orderliness of God's wonderful creation, and for that vast supply of God's goodness that we have known about and celebrated because of his history of generations of God's people since time has been known and recorded. Just as the psalmist prayed, so we pray. May God be merciful and bless us. May his face smile with favor on us, and may the warmth of God's loving goodness be seen, known, and recognized by all creation.
We gather to celebrate the vastness of God's great mercy towards all peoples and nations, and give thanks that it cannot be retained by one race of people or by any one nation, but that God's gracious mercy overflows all humanly constructed borders and boundaries, and spreads its warmth over all who will receive it and give thanks for its blessings. Today, we pray that God's ways and actions may be understood and known amongst the peoples of all nations, languages, and cultures, and that no matter what has been their personal experiences of God, that they all may know the power of God's loving liberation from all that oppresses or restricts people's relationship with God.
Your grace and mercy brought me through. I'm living this moment because of you. And I want to thank you, Lord. I want to thank you and praise you.
may be seated. We continue with our prayer of confession. Lord, we can only imagine the scene painted for us in Revelation, in which we are given a glimpse of eternity. The light of your love pours over all the land, bathing it in healing warmth and hope. We gathered this day to celebrate the gift of Jesus Christ. He said to the disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid." How many times we are troubled and fearful. We feel hopeless in the face of an uncertain future. Help us to place our trust in your love. Open our hearts to see the wonder of your eternity. Release us from our anger, loneliness, and despair. Bring us to the realization that in your love we may find peace and joy.
Lord, you know how easy it is for us to sit here, tethered to our darkness and fear. We get bound up by chains of mistrust. We dare not to hope, for so many times before we have been disappointed. So we sit here and wonder where you are. We are not unlike the disciples who wandered also, who feared. Lord, come to us in our darkness. Flood us with your powerful light of love and mercy. Help open our eyes to the good news of your eternal glory. Give to us visions of the place in which love and hope will reign. Forgive our stubborn resistance to your mercy and your love.
I cry out for your hand of mercy to heal me. Oh,
Before you in prayer, we are painfully aware that the earth itself is at risk from the ways your people live on it and the conflicts we provoke among each other. We seek your healing and hope this day for the earth and all its creatures and for your people of every nation. We pray for peace with justice to emerge in war-torn lands and in every place of conflict, where power struggles put innocence at risk. We name before you the people and places on our hearts today. Send your spirit of wisdom and compassion to break open the hearts of leaders to work with each other to protect the innocent and restore order for the well-being of all. May our ways of truth and justice prevail in every heart and in every land. God of mercy,
hear our cry.
God of healing and hope, we know that this land we call home faces conflict and pain, and that communities are divided by deep disagreements. We pray for the healing and understanding to deepen among all. Protect those who face discrimination daily, and restore dignity and hope to those who have suffered injustice. Open our hearts to build new relationships with each other so we grow closer as neighbors and friends. God of mercy,
hear our cry.
God of healing and hope, we pray for the renewal of your creation and for the protection of species at risk. By your Spirit, teach us to change our ways when they are harmful to the earth and inspire our ingenuity to find solutions to problems that seem so vast. God of mercy,
hear our cry.
God of healing and hope, we pray that those who know sickness or pain, for all who live in grief, loneliness, or anxiety, and all who find these uncertain times overwhelming in any way, in silence, we remember before you those for whom we have special concern this day. By your Spirit, surround each one with strength and love and equip us to offer support for those lives are woven into ours. God of mercy,
hear our cry.
God of healing and hope, Jesus walks with us day by day to see us through every challenge, and so we claim the healing and hope he offers in the world in the words he taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Good morning once again. Today is Youth Sunday, and I invite the children and young people to stand as we sing, "Stand Up for Jesus, Children, Stand Up." Youths and children. Stand up, stand up, stand up for Jesus, children, stand up. Bye.
Stand up for Jesus. The strife will not be long. This day the noise of battle, the next the victor's song. To him that overcometh, a crown of life shall be. He with the King of glory shall reign eternally. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are thankful for this morning that we can stand in your presence. Lord, we come this morning to honor you because you are God of all and there is none like you. We come this morning, O God, to magnify and glorify your name because of your many blessings you have bestowed upon us as individual and as a church. Lord, I stand for parents this morning who see to it that their children comes out to church regularly. I stand for those, O God, who for whatever reason do not see the importance of bringing up their children the way you say we ought to. So Lord, as these children and young people stand before us this morning, we pray, O God, your outpouring of blessings upon them. I pray, O God, that you put a deep desire in their heart to live a life, Lord, pleasing to you. That you, O God, would be the example that they follow. Heavenly Father, you have given us your word. And in your word, you say we are to bring up the children in the nurture and admonition of Jesus Christ. Young people and children, please let Jesus be your example. Our parents cannot be our example. Our teachers ought not to be our example. And if you are able to read your Bible, I pray that you would take it up every day. Even if you read one verse of scripture and you go over it until you comprehend what the word says, it would be a blessing to you. So Lord God Almighty, I pray, Lord, that you would instill in these children and young people a desire to know you and have a close, intimate relationship with you, O God. Then they would see the blessings flowing upon them in their school, in their work, in their family, in their community, wherever they are, O God, wherever they go, your blessing will be upon them. So Lord, I pray that you would anoint them afresh this morning from the crown of their head to the soles of their feet. And whatever the desire of their heart is, Lord, as long it would bring you honor and glory and praise, I know, O God, that you would see it come through. So Lord, each child I bring before you, each young person, each person this morning I bring before you, O God, and pray, Lord, that you would just pour out your anointing upon them from the crown of their heads to the sole of their feet. I know that some of them come from difficult situations in their homes, O God, and I pray, Lord, that you would encourage them to be the Bible that their family might read. I pray, Lord, that you would encourage them to be the Bible that their peers might read, because they would live a life, Lord, that is pleasing to you, and that they would be examples that others would follow. Help them not to take this opportunity to come into your presence week after week for granted. Help them not to take the opportunity to go in Sunday school sessions for granted, Lord. But I pray, mighty God, that you would just open their hearts with a deep desire, Lord, to know you. To know you for themselves, oh God. And what a wonderful thing that would be when they can know you. Lord, we have opportunity after opportunity to tell others of your goodness and of your love. But sometimes we come and we don't get the fill that we need because we are distracted. So Lord God Almighty, I pray this morning that you would just move all distractions from their mind this morning and help them to focus on the things that are happening here and now. That they, oh God, receive the blessing so that they can impart to others. Mighty God, I just pray your anointing on each individual, Lord. Whatever they aspire to be, oh God, know, Lord. Help them to know, Lord, that they can be it because you love them and you care about them. So I pray, oh God, that you would instill a desire to love you in their hearts this morning and that they would work after it, oh God. Heavenly Father, I pray, Lord, that you would anoint each of them this morning from the crown of their heads to the sole of their feet. I pray, oh God, that you would be a hedge of protection around them, that no danger would come nigh them, oh God. Lord God Almighty, to you, receive the honor, the glory, and the praise, and continue to bless them, I pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Before we receive the offering, we're going to repeat the offertory sentence.
God has created a world of great diversity, full of wonder and potential. Let us honor God's gifts to us in Christ and in each other as we present our offering in support of God's purposes in the world.
The choir will now bless us with a rendition as we receive this morning's offering. Say thank you to the choir. Let us pray. Dear God and Heavenly Father, we come once again into your sanctuary, into your kingdom sanctuary. We thank you even now for another opportunity to give back to your work. And God, we pray that for those who didn't have it to give, that you would create an avenue for them, just for them to return a portion to you, God. Remind us that we should indeed return a portion back to you for the furtherance of your kingdom. All these we ask in your name. Amen. A very hearty welcome is extended to all sharing in our worship today. If you are curious and have come to see, if you are weary and have come to find rest, if you are grateful and have come to give thanks, if you are hurting and have come for solace, if you are listening and have come to pray, welcome. I indeed welcome all of us here this morning into the sanctuary. Do we have any new family members that we have not yet met? No. No new faces. Okay. So we are all at home. Sunday school follows this service. Membership class follows this service as well. Evening manna will be on Tuesday via Zoom at 7 p.m. There will be no prayer meeting this Saturday morning. Our color offering for the month of May is orange. We continue to receive our walk-up offering for the building fund. The 33rd Provincial Synod of the Eastern West Indies Province will be held from July 17th to 22nd, 2022. It will be held in hybrid fashion. Conference delegates will be together in each conference, and the officers of Synod will be together in Antigua. Please keep the upcoming Synod in our prayers. I want to stop here and ask if we have anyone celebrating birthday in the sanctuary today or during the course of the week. Okay, so we have one tiny tot at the back.
Good morning, church. Tuesday. Zanaya will be celebrating birthday on Tuesday.
Okay, so we have one on Tuesday.
Good morning on Thursday.
And we have Sister Akenja on Thursday. Let us sing we have Jordan Francis and Zanaya Simmons on the 24th, Nyla Lake on the 25th, Maya Lake and Seymour Davis on the 27th. Let us sing the happy birthday song for our celebrants, please.
A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. Each day of the year, may you find Jesus there. A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. The best that you ever had. A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. Each day of the year, may you find Jesus there. A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. The best that you ever had.
Internet, can you pray for our birthday celebrants, please?
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks, we give you praise, the honor, and the glory for yet another milestone in the lives of these young people. We pray, oh God, that as they celebrate, God, that they remember you and put you first in their lives, dear God. Those who do not know you as yet, God, as a little infant behind you, God, I pray that her mother, God, may teach her the ways of you, God, that as she grows, that she will grow to know you and become, let you become the savior of her lives. Father God, even now I ask, God, that you may cover them with the blood of Jesus. Build that hedge of protection around them, God, that as they go from day to day, that, Lord God, that they will be protected by you. Father God, we say thank you, God, for yet another milestone. Thank you, God, for yet another time to celebrate life. God, and I pray, God, that they may come to know that the life that they celebrate is in Christ Jesus. And we say thank you in no other name but in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Amen.
I'm sorry, do we have any anniversaries? Anyone celebrating an anniversary? Okay, we don't have any. Okay.
God is good. And all the time.
God is good.
I want to bring you greetings from the Methodist Church. Amen. In Nevis. Praise the Lord. Amen. You did pray for me. I remember that I was in Nevis, right?
Yes.
So I bring you greetings from the church there. We had a wonderful time in the Lord. God was indeed, he showed up and he showed off, and God was indeed faithful. And so they greet you. And although they apologize because the announcement all went out to say that I was from the Moravian Church in Keon, but it was quickly remedied to let them know that it was the one in Mansion, Ebenezer Estridge, but that I am, you know, born there and grew up there. So, but it was wonderful, and many did not realize that I had so many family members in Nevis whom I was able to visit with, and quite a few of them also came to the services on the different days. So God has been good and faithful, and I know that he continued to be faithful with us here in St. Kitts. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor. Okay, so we continue in our notices. Our annual food fair is this Saturday, May 28th. We continue to solicit your assistance in cash and kind. We're going to invite Sister Nama to the podium to give us a bit more information on our upcoming food fair. Just that, just more information about the food fair, right?
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Some of us are a little vertically challenged, but it's okay. Good morning, brothers and sisters. Yes, I know I missed out last week, but I'm sure Sister Kendria tried to fill my shoes, but they're a little tiny, so it didn't work out too well. So I'm back so that we can get back on track, because we only have 1 week. We have a full week. See? Less than a week. Hold this, Sister Kendria. Hold this. So we have less than a week to go. And since I am somewhat half African, I always like to keep up with the African proverbs. And there's an African proverb that says, teeth that are together help each other in chewing food. Let me say that again. Teeth that are together help each other in chewing food. Now I know there are some of us who've somewhat lost some of our teeth, but that's where dentures come in, okay? So fear not, the dentures will help, but it is important that all the teeth come together in order to chew the food, not just on Saturday, because I done making my list. I'm going to be here all day, just like many of you, and I will be having, mommy, you'll be making breakfast for me? Yeah. So somebody please make breakfast for me so that I will continue to do the work of the Lord. And I'll be having lunch right down there. All my snacks, any diet is out the window, through the door. No dieting on that day at all. So lunch right down there, snacks right down there, supper, dinner, whatever you want to call it, right down where? Right down there, we are all going to be having all our meals down there this coming Saturday. But not just us, everyone we know must pass for at least one meal. You will have areas to sit down, so don't worry, you ain't got to stand up and eat your food. You can sit down, enjoy, and then don't go to the bouncy castle right after you have eaten. But there are other things that you can partake of. There will be entertainment, persons that you haven't been able to chit-chat with for quite some time. Try to find out how Sister so-and-so and Brother so-and-so are doing, and let's fellowship with one another. But let's not forget, teeth that are together help each other in chewing food, which means not just the chewing food on Saturday, but actually making this thing come together on Saturday. It means every single tooth has to play its part. There are different types of teeth. I'm not going to try to pretend to be a dentist and know all the different types of teeth, but the molars are, you know, I think that's probably the only one I remember. They are important. Thank you, Brother Norval. Thank you. Yes, so you have all of those teeth. That means everyone has a role to play. Do not think your role is insignificant or minimal, and so you might dismiss it. Everyone's role is important, even if it means just coming and wiping someone's brow. Even if it means just coming and standing next to the person and talk with them, give them the energy to continue. Even if it means coming in and just stepping in for someone and then going back. But just note, even the runners, especially the runners who have to be up and down, trying to get everything set up, everyone's role is important in order to chew the food properly. So, some of us have pledged contributions. Some contributions have come in and some are still outstanding. So I believe pay week is this week. You don't have to wait till pay week. You go borrow it and then they're going to give them back. But we kind of need it ASAP. So let those contributions come in. Some of us have pledged items. Bring in your items, especially if you know those items require preparation. Ensure that you get them in as soon as possible. The office, the health fair. Remember, we're going to be having the health fair. Now, I know the nurses may not be able to check all your teeth, but they can check something else. They can check your pressure. They can check your sugar, all sorts of things will be happening. So the health fair is going to be up here. So I would advise, especially those of you whose sugar is a little bit not so certain, come check your sugar, then know what you can consume down there. And at intervals, come back and check the sugar. Make sure everything is on par, because we do not want to have any incidents. Okay? Amen. For those of you whose pressure is up there, make sure you maintain, balance this all a little bit, and all will be well. For those of you who know you cannot watch the children for long periods of time, Cindy is here to assist. She will watch your children while they are on the bouncy castle and all of that. So make sure for those of you with pledges, you bring in those items that you have pledged. Contributions, bring in those contributions. I know it has been years, because this is crunch down, which means this is cooking week. I know it's been a while for some of us, especially cooking in these quantities. So call up your tante, make your grandmother. Ask her for the tips them. You might have forgotten some of them. And for those of you who, you know, your grandmother's cutting style at this time, YouTube is always there. There's a secret ingredient. Go and check it out. Watch some YouTube videos. Amen. YouTube University is very helpful when it comes to the kitchen. So, at the end of the day, all teeth play a part in chewing food. So each and every one of us plays a part. You have to do what you can for this week. Do not wait until you're called upon. Just volunteer yourselves. You can call the good reverend. She will be there. You can call Sister Alicia. You can call Sister Joanne. You can call Sister Gislin. If you attempt to call me, you may not get through. So call all the other individuals. Right? Rev or Sister Carla in the office. Sister Alicia, that's a good bet. Sister Joanne, that's a good bet. Sister Gislin is a good bet. Sister Nama is not a good bet to call. So, not at all. No. I'm a tooth that does other things. You see, you must know where your strength lies. and capitalize on that, okay? So contributions come in as soon as possible, pledges come in as soon as possible, and on the 28th, where are we gonna be? Right down there. Invite everyone you know. As the first message that I delivered to you said, do not say no for anyone. Invite everyone. Sister Cindy?
We say a special thank you to Sister Nama for keeping us abreast of what is going to happen next week, Saturday, on the mansion. Sorry, Saturday, May 28th, on Mansion Lawns. Our annual food fair is back. We continue as we prepare our hearts for the word. The first reading comes to us from Acts 16, verse 9 to 15. This will be read by Zachary Williams. The second reading from John 14, 23 to 29. This will be read by Kiani Wana.
Morning, church.
Morning.
The scripture. The scripture reading is taken from Acts chapter 16, verses 9 to 15. And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. There stood a man from Macedonia and prayed him, saying, come over into Macedonia and help us. After he had seen the vision, he immediately endeavored to go into Macedonia, assuredly gathered that the Lord called us to preach the gospel unto them, therefore losing them, thus as we come into a straight course to some Samaria, and the next day to Annapolis, and from thence to Philippi, which is the chief city of the part of Macedonia, and the colony we were in, the city abiding certain days. And the Sabbath we went out the city by the riverside, where prayer was wont to be made. And we sat down and spoke unto women which restored dear to them. And a certain woman named Lydia, seller of purple of the city of Tyre, which worshiped God, hear us, whose heart the Lord opened that she attend unto the things which were spoken of Paul. And when she was baptized, and her household besought us, saying, if we have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come unto my house and abide there. And she was constrained us. This is the will of the Lord.
Good morning, church. Our scripture reading will be taken from John chapter 14, verses 23 to 29. Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him. And we will come unto him and make our abode with him. He that loveth me not, keepeth not my sayings, and the word which ye hear is not mine, but the Father's which sent me. These things have I spoken unto you, but yet present with you, but the being yet present with you, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things,
and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Ye have heard how I said unto you, I go away and come again unto you. If ye loved me, ye would rejoice, because I said, I go unto the Father, for my Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it come to pass, that when it is come to pass, ye might believe. This is the word of the Lord. To God.
We have in our midst this morning Sister Belinda Bat from the Bethesda New Dawn Pastorate. We say a special welcome to her. And after, I invite you to stand as we prepare our hearts for the word which God would have laid on her heart. We sing, "Hide me now under your wings, cover me within your mighty hand."
Hide me now under your wings. Cover me within your mighty hand. Hide me now.
Amongst all, I've made so many mistakes that God should have disqualified me. But glory be to God, He still sees something. And so I have answered yes to the call to be at Ebenezer this morning because of what God has done. And because of His grace and His mercy, He has given me one more opportunity to tell someone of the love of Jesus Christ and the Father and His plan for us. And so even now, God, I pray that You would just have Your divine way. Father God, we pray even now, Lord God, that Your Spirit will take full control. We have asked for it in song, God, and we pray even now that our spirits will be opened up, God, to hear what You have to say. God, from this sacred place, God, we have come to meet You. We have come, God, for something fresh. For something new, Lord God, we have come for a quickening, God. And so we pray even now, Holy Spirit, that You would just have Your way. That You would block out every iniquity, Lord God, that our sins may not stand in the way of us receiving Your word, God. But that You, O God, whose word says that You are faithful and just to forgive us, God. That we will receive Your forgiveness that You have offered us this morning. And that we would receive Your word without condemnation. For You have said in Your word, God, neither do I condemn thee. Go thy way and sin no more. And so, mighty God, we just thank You for this opportunity, God. We thank You for the gift of life. We thank You for the breath that You have lent us, God. We thank You that we are able to stand and that our faculties are working, God. We thank You, God. We come with a shout of thanksgiving, God. We say thank You. For so many, God, it is impossible to do. So, God, with the lifting of our hands and with the clapping of our hands, God, and with the raising of our voices, God, we say thank You. And so with a thankful heart, God, we say have Your way. Have Your way, Lord God, have Your way. Meet us as the point of our need because You are the omniscient one. omnipotent one, God. There isn't any situation that is in our life, God, that you cannot roll away, God. And so as we sang, God, we roll them at your feet. We roll them, God, all our cares and our burdens. We roll them, God, before you. We roll them, mighty God. And we say, God, you who said, Lord God, to cast our cares upon you, for your yoke is easy and your burden is light. God, take ours. We give them to you this morning, God, in the mighty name of Jesus. And we pray with thanksgiving, Lord God. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My brothers and my sisters, it is a struggle. Glory to God. I don't know the good reverend, they do it. I guess you have to go to school, but it is indeed a struggle. But the word of God is not that difficult. And if it is only one message that we bring, it is that Jesus loves us, then it is good enough. Hallelujah. I realize that for 2 years we have been shut down. Locked down and almost locked down completely. And for 2 years we have not had that, the big festivities and all of those things. But this year it's different. And so the gates have been thrown open and our people have been desperate for that reveling and everything like that. And one of the big events that is staged or set to be staged is the music festival. And I listened to the ad and it says it promises to be the best one yet. You see, the lineup is long and extensive, and even those in my family members, though, they are preparing and they are planning which night they want to go and how many tickets they can afford, and they are boys, but even them, they are already preparing what it is that they want to wear. So I can only imagine the girls. Plans are being made to revel for 3 nights, sparing no costs. Yet, when the church calls for a week of revival services, there are all kinds of excuses. But guess what? That's another story for another time. No. I've stopped by Ebenezer this morning to tell us that even though we are planning, and I've been called to the young people, but can I say that I'm going to speak to those of us young at heart and those of us so not at young at heart as well? Because all of us need to hear that even though we are planning and making our plans what it is that we want to do, whether we want to go or whether we don't want to go. And even while we are preparing, whether I want to wear this or whether I want to wear that, we are not the only one planning. We are not the only one who have made preparation. There is someone else who have planned. Can I tell us, the book maybe look long, but it's not long. It's just that I write big. Don't get scared. I won't be long. You see, there is one who has made the plan of this world and this earth and this universe. And he has constantly made preparation for us. And in all our planning and in all our preparation of what it is that we want to do and how we want to live, and excluding God sometimes, my prayer is that we do not be caught off guard. The prophet Isaiah, and permit me to read from chapter 40, reading verses 1 to 9, and I'll be quick. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem. Tell her that her sad days are gone and her sins are pardoned. Yes, the Lord has punished her twice over for all her sins. Listen, it's the voice of someone shouting. Clear the way through the wilderness for the Lord. Make straight the highway through the wasteland for our God. Fill in the valleys and level the mountains and hills. Straighten the curves and smooth the rough places. Then the glory of the Lord will be revealed and all people will see it together. The Lord has spoken. Shout to the people. People are like grass. Their beauty fades as quickly as the flowers in the field. The grass withers and the flowers fadeth beneath the breath of the Lord. So it was with the people. The grass withered and the flowers faded, but the word of God stands forever. Zion, messenger of good news, shout from the mountaintops. Shout it loud, O Jerusalem. Shout and do not be afraid. Tell the towns of Judah. your God is coming. And that is simply what I have stopped by to say, that our God is coming. And in all our planning and in all our preparation, the message is still simply clear. God is coming. You see, I have spent many a times in these walls and I have received many a touch from God. And my young people, if I can speak to you this morning, I've come to tell you that God is coming. And from time to time immemorial, we have heard the word that says that Jesus is coming. And many times we can hear a person saying, since Noah built the ark, God coming and ain't reached yet. But can I tell us that the one thing with God, that when he promises something, it does not come back void. When God promises something, it is yea and amen. When God promises something, it has to be fulfilled. If I can just give us a backdrop of this Isaiah 40 passage. God, after all the children of Israel had been through, they were still being rebellious to God. They were still wanting to live the way that they wanted to do. They were still wanting to pay tributes to foreign gods and false idols. And God had a plan for them. He said to them in chapter 10, I'm going to put you where I can find you, and that's me summarizing. And even with all of that, he promised them that even though I do this, I'm still going to save you. I'm still going to restore you. I'm still going to leave a remnant. And so God says to them, you're going to be in captivity. I'm going to put you where I can find you. And the first set of people he put them over to were the Assyrians. And then after that, he gave them again to the Babylonian. Now imagine being in bondage by two different sets of people. They must have had it rough. But there are some of us that just has to learn a hard lesson, myself included. It seems as though I can't learn nothing else but hard lessons. And so God constantly has to whip me with many stripes. God constantly has to put me where he can find me. He's got to put me to a place where after all is done and said, all I can do is trust him. But I think I'm finished with the hard lessons. I'm declaring even now as I stand here, I'm finished with the hard lessons because our words are powerful. Disaster was going to come upon the children of Israel because God had planned it. He planned their disaster. He planned captivity. But God did not leave them without a hope. And so he promised them that he is going to bring about a remnant. He's going to leave a handful of them, just a fraction of them, so that when it is all done and said, they will be able to declare that God is God. In verse 9, he concludes that your God is coming. This is what the prophet Isaiah is saying. And so Isaiah leaves us knowing that God persists in his plans and God succeeds. God's plan never failed yet. Young people, can I tell you that God's plan never failed yet? And if it is that you have made a plan for your life and you have excluded God, then you are bound to fail. But if you include God in your plan, then God's plan never fails. He can only succeed. That is who he is. Glory be to God. You see, time does not limit God from performing his will for his word. It doesn't matter how long it takes. God will perform the will of his word, especially over our lives. And if we can move forward to some more contemporary times, we move over to Matthew chapter 5. I said time does not permit God from performing the will of his word. And so in Isaiah 40, God said to the children of Jerusalem, I am coming, your God is coming. And here he is now in Matthew chapter 5. And God is saying, Jesus is now on the scene. And he's speaking to his disciples. And many of us know Matthew chapter 5 by the Beatitudes. Blessed are they that mourn, blessed are they the peacemakers, and blessed are this and blessed are that. But there is a part in chapter 5, verse 17, where Jesus is speaking to his disciples and he says, do not misunderstand why I have come. I did not come to abolish the law of Moses or the writings of the prophet. No, I came to accomplish their purpose. He says, I tell you the truth, that until heaven and earth disappear, even the smallest details of God's law will not disappear. Its purpose is until its purpose is achieved. I am going somewhere, my brothers and sisters, because I need for us to realize that in Isaiah, the Old Testament, God promised that he was coming. And then in the New Testament, the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John speaks to us of Jesus coming. God did not just show up on the scene. He made preparations. He made preparation of a virgin young lady by the name of Mary and allowed for conception through the Holy Spirit that he would plant himself within her. He further made preparation of a man named Joseph, who was the engaged to be married to Mary. And he did this to prepare him so that he would not abandon her in her times of need, but that he would lend a fatherly structure and help and aid to the young Jesus, God incarnate. God made other preparations. He prepared an old barren lady by the name of Elizabeth and an old priest and that were well beyond his childbearing age, and they conceived the child. And this child is whom we know as John the Baptist. And that child, the preparation of that child was to declare the word of God. Prepare ye the way. Make straight in the deserts, for God is coming. And John declared the coming of Jesus Christ. John declared the coming of Jesus Christ. This was God fulfilling himself, that he would honor his word. And Jesus brought clarity to it. He said, I didn't come to abolish the word. I didn't come to eliminate the word and to make it null and void. I came to fulfill it. But that promise of God and Jesus coming, he has not ended as yet. When Jesus left this earth, he says to his disciples, I'm coming again. One last time, I'm coming again. And can I speak to all of us here, myself first? It is for us to make our preparations now. It is for us to make our plans now. I don't know if you have a plan. I have a friend that is chancing it. He says that if it happens, and if it is so, then. But for now, he's just living. And that seems to be the motto of our young people. We are just living. We are just doing what it is that we want to do. There's no plan. Our plan is just perhaps to have fun. But there is an assurance. There is an assurance that Jesus is coming again. We find this in Revelation chapter 21. Well, the whole of Revelation speaks to the coming of Christ, and that is the synopsis of it all. That at the end of it, after all of this, as much long as it takes, God is coming again. And the truth of it, brothers and sisters, this is a word that we don't like to preach. This is a word that has been so long left from the altars and from men and women who should be reminding us constantly that God is coming again, that we are to keep our eyes on the prize. It was Paul who said, lest I be disqualified. Paul was running a race, and he understood that at the end of the race, there is one thing that he has to gain, and that is to be in heaven. And so these are the days that we cannot afford to lose our zeal and our zest for the impending Christ, the appearance of Christ, the Maranatha, that thing where God will crack the eastern sky. There were many, many sermon topics, and if I show you this pad, I have at least 5 sermon topics. I prayed, and I'm like, God, what am I supposed to say? And I've been preparing for some time now. But when it boiled all down to it, all I could hear was to tell my people that I am coming. I am coming. I don't know the last time you heard someone told you. I know that we know because we've been in Sunday school, we've been in church, we've been here forever. But what is the relationship? What is our relationship with God like? What have we done with his Christ? What have we done with the sacrifice that he made on Calvary's tree? Have we committed our lives fully and solely to him? Or are we squandering the grace that God has paid such a price for. Plans and final preparations have been made. And in the book of John, Revelation, the Lord says, look. In verse 22, chapter 22 and verse 7, he says, look, I am coming soon. Blessed are those whose words of prophecy are written in this book. And in verse 12, he says again, look, I am coming, bringing my reward with me to repay all people according to their deeds. I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. And so I did not come with a lot of shouts and hoops and anything like that. No fancy words, just a simple word to us this morning that God is coming. And where are we? Where are we? Where is our relationship? What is our relationship like? Are we stagnant? Are we lukewarm? Because the word of God says that he will spew us out of his mouth. He wished that we were either hot or cold. And I remember coming to this church many a times when there are revival services. I used to dread coming down here. Because I know every time I come down here, it's going to be licks. I know every time I come down here, I'm going to be at this altar, snotting and bawling. And even as recent as several years ago, I was at this very altar, still snotting, still bawling, as much as I'm 40-something. And I have no shame about it. I recall one time sitting right at the back there, because I didn't want to come in front of the church. And even as the pastor preached and he preached and he preached, my head pulled towards the shop outside. I didn't want to face this way because I knew that God had a conviction on my life. But I wanted still to do the things of the world. I still wanted to gravitate to the things of the world. And so I turned my head towards the shop because I figure that is what I want. I still wanted to do that. I still wanted to drink. I still wanted to lime. I still wanted to have my way. But before the night was over, I was at this altar snotting and bawling, surrendering yet again to God. And I don't know why Reverend Binta asked me to share a word with our young people, but all I can give to you is what I have. And what I have is the fact that God's grace extends. God's grace extends time and time and time again, and that God is calling our young people to a higher place in him. Young people, you have got to decide. If God be God, serve God. But if Baal be God, then serve him if you choose to. But I know Ezekiel proved that he was not. Elijah proved that he was not God. Baal, that is. But that Yahweh was God. And so, I have stopped to encourage our young people. You see, you may have many blessings. You may be blessed in looks and physique and clothing and education. You may be blessed with a good family and a good home. But if all of that fades in comparison, if you do not have God. And can I tell you, I know that there is a trick where we serve in God and we do things and we are part of this board and that board, but our souls are not sold out for God. I speak from experience because I was on several things. I was here, there, and yet I still was not sold out for God. When God is desiring more of us, God is desiring us to come to a higher place in him. Every time God sent a word to his people, he called them up. He called Moses on the top of the mountain. Even Jesus, when he was doing the Beatitudes, he said he went up on a mountain. And seeing the people, he went up on the mountain. He's calling us up, my brothers and my sisters, my young people. God is calling us up. He's calling us to give our best. He's calling us to give better. He's no longer the mediocre. But allow God and allow the Holy Spirit to birth something in you that can be passionate. He's calling us to be passionate about him. It was a passion God had for us why he hung on a cross. It was a passion he had to see our souls saved, why he took on death, why he became a curse for us. It had to be a passion. I know sometimes when we are in love, Sister Cindy, we say, you know, we passion. And so we do all manner of things. You know, we walk, we hold hands, we hug, we love up in the public. We don't care who's watching us because of passion. So where's our passion for Jesus Christ? The one who loves us beyond anything. Where's our passion? And so this morning, if it is that our passion is because of the cares of the world and because of the things that we have gone through, trust me, I have been through it. I think the only thing left now for me to go through is death in terms of myself. But I have been through it. And because of what I have been through, I almost wanted to take my life. I wanted to give up. I did not want to stay in this face of this earth. But God, if I had my way, I would not be here this morning standing before you. And I don't know what it is that any of you are going through. I don't know what the hurt is in your heart. I don't know what it is that have triggered you or made you to lose your passion, your zeal. But even as I paid attention this morning to the worship, I sensed passion was missing. That thing that says, God, I love you because of who you are. God, I love you for what it is that you have done for me. And even though I have been through hurt after hurt, and even though I have experienced hardship after hardship, and even though I have experienced loss, God, that person that I love so much, I have lost them. God, I still trust you. God, I still believe that you are. God, I am still passionate about you because I know one day you are coming again. I know according to Revelation that a new Jerusalem is going to the heavens and earth are going to pass away and that a new Jerusalem is going to be here. I know, God, that your word promises that you are coming back for us and that we will spend eternity with you. And so for that reason, God, I can be passionate. For that reason, God, I can love you. I can sing praises unto you. I can declare your goodness to the people that I meet because you are truly good. For you are good. For you are good, for you are good to me. For you are good, God, for you are good, for you are good to me. God has been good. And he continues to be good. And so if God is so good to us, why are we halfway? I'm speaking to myself. Why are we halfway? Why are we halfway? God woke us up this morning and he lent us breath. His breath is in our lungs and I thank God that he has not withheld them because we will be dead like Auntie Granny Fowler. Why are we halfway? That is my only purpose in mansion. This morning. That is my only purpose at Ebenezer this morning, to encourage someone that God has been good and to encourage us to make that step. It's not a perfect road, but to make that step to say, God, I am coming. God, I want you to remove the emptiness that I feel. God, I want you to remove the hurt, the abandonment that I feel. God, I want you to remove that thing that seeks to block me from giving you my best. I want to give you my best. I want to give you my best, God. I want to give you my best, God. For all I have to offer is yours. All I can offer, God, is yours. You are good, God. For you are good. For you are good. For you. morning who wants to say, God, I've been doing mediocre, but I want passion. I want to give you my all, God, because you have been good. I want you to restore my passion, God. I want you to restore the joy of my love, that first love. Control. Is that where you are this morning? I've come to invite us to a place of warmth. I've come to invite us to a place where God can wrap his arms around us and assure us that all will be well. We've had some broken dreams and we've had some tears. We've had our hearts torn in two, and the things that we planned for did not work out. I got married some time back and I planned and I swore it would last forever. I had determined within myself that regardless to what come, I'm gonna tough it out. I'm gonna make this marriage work. But plans changed and today I'm divorced. And to be honest with you, the enemy hit me a blow with that one because I was ashamed that it didn't work out. I thought it would last. And that's one of the times that depression tried to hold me. I had to start all over again. I was at a low place physically, emotionally, because I didn't feel loved. I felt like I wasn't good enough. But God reassured me that yes, Jesus loved me, and that is enough. Yes, I still get lonely, and yes, sometimes I still think that I want to remarry, and then I say, nah, too tiring. I ain't in the mood. Tiring. Cindy, I want you to get married. I declare it in the name of Jesus. But it's tiring for me. And I don't know what plans God have for me. And if that is his plan, then I will receive it. But that's not a part of my plan right now. But what are your plans like this morning? Have you planned with God in the center of it? Or have you put him on the side and just take him up when you need him? Is Jesus at the center of it all? Or is he just a convenience? Do you want your passion, or do you want to give him your all? Do you want him to revive that thing that you once felt? I invite us to the altar this morning. If you don't mind taking a walk and saying, devil, I'm done with this. I'm done with this mediocre thing. Then I invite you to meet me at the altar. Because I believe that there is something that God wants to do amongst the people of Ebenezer. It is a wellspring. It is a place where persons have connected and have experienced God. It was at this church that I first experienced God and experienced the move of the Holy Spirit. I wish Jolene was here to testify with me. And for that, this church will always be dear to my heart. It is one of the testimonies that I give of when I first experienced the Holy Spirit. And so I know that the Holy Spirit, that element of God that revives us, that keeps us zealous about him, is here, has always been. Do you want your zeal restored this morning? The altar is open. I don't know what your situation is, but God is able. God is able. Come home. Come home. Before we sing the next verse, this is my question to you. If God were to come now, if his eastern sky were to crack now, and you were to stand before God, would heaven be your abode? Or would he say to you, depart from me, I know you not? And I'm asking that from the pulpit to the pew. I'm not taking a chance. I'm not taking a chance. Reverend Binta, if you can be so kind to just bear us up in prayer, because this is my spot. This is my spot. If God were to crack the eastern sky, would heaven be your home? Or would God say to you, depart from me? You have not made the grade. Consider. Consider. I thank you. I thank the host pastor for inviting me. I thank you for sitting and being so listening. I thank you. Oh God.
Why should we tarry when Jesus is pleading?
Why should we tarry when Jesus is pleading? For you.
always say, I don't want you to come and accept Jesus because you're afraid that today may be your last. I don't want you to accept Jesus because you hear that Jesus is coming soon. I don't want you to accept Jesus because you're frightened that if he come now, or if you're dead now, you're going to hell. I want you to accept Jesus because of what he has done for us. Because he loves us so much that he died for us. He gave him life, his life for us. And because of that, we in turn want to love him and be passionate about him. So in your heart, just talk with the Lord and ask him to give you that desire to love him and come to him. Ask him to help you not to come to him for fear. Because if you come because you're afraid, after a couple of days you're not dead. You say, oh, I'm not dead. I'm still here. I'm continuing my ways. But if you love him because of what he has done for you, for what he continues to do for you, when you accept him, even when you fall, you'll realize his grace and his mercy is still there, bearing me help. Let us pray. Oh God and our Father, we thank you for your word, your reminder that you are going to return one day. In spite of that, Lord God, and we think that that day will never come, ignite within our hearts that passion, that desire to live for you and to serve you. We thank you for your grace and your mercy that continues to uphold us every single day. That no matter what we do, there's nothing at all that can keep us away from your love. No matter where we go, no matter how bad we think we are or how bad things are with us, we thank you that you continue to uphold us with your righteous right hand. So Lord God, even as Sister Tudor and Sister Belinda stands at the altar this morning, we are grateful for their recommitment of their lives into your hands. We ask that you strengthen them, that you meet their need, Lord God, according to your riches in glory in Christ Jesus. And all of us in the congregation who yearn and long, Lord God, to continue serving you or to begin serving you, give us that fire, Lord God, that revives us and pulls us up, that reminds us that you are strong and able to keep us from falling. And that even if you do fall, we do fall, you are the great shepherd that will come and pick us up and carry us on your shoulder until we have the strength to walk again. So Lord God, bless our word today. The word that went forth, bless it and help us at all times to glorify your name. Walk with us. Go with us. Before us. And strengthen us all the days of our lives. In Jesus' precious name. Amen.
We thank God for his word this morning, and I trust that some soul was blessed. At this time, we stand and we sing our closing hymn. I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. Let us all stand. I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his goodness, of his precious blood atonement, then I repented of my sin.
the cleansing blood.
Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Render to no one evil for evil. Support the weak. Love all people. And the blessing of God Almighty, God who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest, remain, and abide with us and all our loved ones now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Father, be thou glorified. Jesus, O thou Lamb of God, may your Spirit fall with us. Amen.
Have a wonderful week, and I expect to begin seeing people from tomorrow. Every day of the week, I expect to see people coming up here to bring something, to do something. Have a wonderful week.